Hello everyone, it's Dom. So here's the thing, if you're struggling to grasp all those new AI applications, chatbots, like probably there are thousands of them, you're not alone. So in this video, I did the hard work and I reviewed most of them, hopefully all the most important ones, and I created the comparison table. I listed all of them and then I created columns with special features so you can compare them one to another and see which one is the best fit for you. I did the hard work, you can benefit from it. I think after this video, you're gonna have like an 80% of the knowledge of all the AI chatbots out there. I think I highlighted the best cool individual features, and during the video, I will answer the question like which one should be used by whom. I'll give you an example. My daughter is talking to one particular chatbot app, which I personally find boring. If you're an advanced user, especially for you, I created a Google spreadsheet. There's a link in the description of this video, so you can just click and see and play around with the table yourself. But I strongly recommend to stick around because I'm going to comment on each individual feature. Oh, and one more thing. If I can ask you for a favor, if you have the information that is missing in this table, please reach out to me on social media or leave a comment under this video. By the way, I will reply to every single comment in this video. So if you have any missing information and you are willing to contribute, please do so. I will greatly appreciate the effort. Okay, so let's move on to the table. So I pre-selected 17 AI chatbot applications to compare. And because the last one is agents, hopefully I'm gonna have some time to discuss it on the end. So let's go for each column. First one is models, basically the number of available models per chatbot or the type of those models behind this chatbot is running. Next is context window, which is basically a number. How many words can you fit as a prompt, as a starting message? So that's basically a short memory context window of AI assistant. The third column is what kind of chatbot type it is, whether it's a native application for the company that owns the model, or it's implementing third-party model, or maybe it's a playground. Next, information, the mobile app is available. Then I'm comparing the cost, or in general, the pricing model. The next column is prompt library, which is basically a template for this starting prompt. I personally believe this is one of the important factors to take into consideration when comparing the chatbot apps. Right, and the rest of the table actually is more technical, more details, whether it's the API is available for developers to use this application in a programmatic way, or some details like the login is required, whether the chatbot can actually browse the internet and fact check what he's talking about. Then there is my favorite, bring your own key, which hopefully finally I'm gonna make a new video about. Then there are more details like dark theme that I think the nerds love that, or tech stack. Right, let's start with ChatGPT. So I know there are 5 models. I put it a star because 4 are available for pretty much everyone who wants to access them, which is ChatGPT, GPT 3.5 Turbo, the fastest one, GPT-4. And then you have the beta models, which is browsing and plugins. And the 5th last one is the alpha model, which is code interpreter. ChatGPT context window is 3000 words. So you can literally copy and paste, I think it's one page of text. Now the type is obviously own models because ChatGPT only serves models that are owned by OpenAI, the creators of ChatGPT. And yesterday it was actually a huge news. OpenAI made it available in the App Store in US. So there's a mobile app now only in US. Now in terms of cost, ChatGPT obviously is free, the basic version, but the pro version that costs $20 per month, I think is the most valuable thing you can get for $20 per month. For prompt libraries, ChatGPT have no prompt templates, but it's got tons of Chrome plugins available. One of the example is PromptStorm, where you can actually search for prompt or you can browse the catalog of templates. In terms of API, the owners of ChatGPT, that is OpenAI, they exposed their models via API for years now. For internet access, I put yes. I know it's only available in the paid version, but it's available for anyone who is willing to pay. So that's why I put yes. Okay, now let's move on to Bing. Bing is actually using very similar to ChatGPT models, because Bing is obviously owned by Microsoft, and Microsoft collaborate with OpenAI. And by the way, all those models are run on the same infrastructure, which on Azure Microsoft Cloud. The key things to say about Bing is that it's free and it's got internet access for free, but you need to use Edge browser to actually get access to it, or just use the mobile app. And I put number three as a number of models for Bing because when you start, you have those three options. Okay, let's move on to Google. Google Chat, Bard got only one model, so there's no options to choose any. And it's running on the latest Palm 2, which is equivalent to GPT-4. And it's for free. If you will compare to OpenAI GPT-4, you need to pay $20 per month for GPT-4. Unfortunately, there's no mobile application, but you have internet access for free, which in OpenAI you need to pay for it. Okay, now let's move on to Perplexity.ai. This one is pretty cool. We've got seven models to choose from. And because here you can choose browsing internet or more scientific information like academic, Wolfram Alpha, Wikipedia, or just casually use for chatting and browsing about YouTube, Reddit, or in general news. There's another cool feature for Perplexity. It's a copilot, which is based on GPT-4, and its role is to actually refine your search query or prompt, and it will suggest you how you can refine your search query for better results. So Perplexity is running their own models. They have their own mobile application and it's for free. Another cool thing is that it doesn't require login, and you've got for free internet access. So now you may ask that, okay, that's fine. All those models are for free. They've got mobile apps. There's no need to log in. There's internet access and it's all for free. So why would I pay $20 per month? But the thing is that when you're using ChatGPT with the same query and you're going to compare the results, you're going to have totally different results. Like ChatGPT have so much better quality results, like Bark, Microsoft, Jasper, Claude, Chatsonic, UChat, Perplexity, Character.ai. This is all good compared to others like SAP, Yellow AI. Okay, they've got Bard, Jasper, so Perplexity actually got good results, but Bard is talking, like, okay, putting Bard the first, which is good, Google. Then Bing, OpenAI Codex, and Copilot, that's pretty much the same. That's actually more to code rather than chat. So unfortunately, Bard didn't get it right, but it created a comparison table, which is so cool, which probably you can actually export to docs. Or not. All right, the next one is Claude. This is actually a model from the company called Anthropic. And this one is very interesting because they don't have their own implementation. Actually, that's not true. They do if you want to install it on the Slack. But basically this Claude model is behind when you use poe.com. They've got the platform to actually use other models, and Claude is one of them, including the biggest one, which got 70,000 words of context window, which is 100,000 tokens. And Claude is actually available for business to business. So just to give you an idea, how much is 70,000 words? So I know that you can put 208 pages of the Great Gatsby book, change one sentence, and the Claude model will spot it in 10 seconds where you change the difference. This is how huge the context window, the short memory of this AI model is. The next one is Open Assistant. They have their own small models. They support a lot of languages. It's free, and they have three very small models. And the whole idea behind Open Assistant is to actually use the community to give them those, to use those models for free, but ask the community to actually help to train those models. So actually the most important thing about Open Assistant is in this one sentence. So they use community to help them train the model, and they are making it actually in a gamification way. So you earn points, you've got the progress bar, you've got the leaderboard, and it's fun for people to actually help them train those models. And it's open. Okay, let's move on. Wow, this one is crazy. Character.ai. So my daughter is crazy about this chatbot. Like, she actually uses it to chat with her favorite anime characters. And whenever we talk about AI, she always brings it up. I personally don't understand it. What's the point of having this? But some people find it valuable. Okay, maybe not even some. This thing is currently valued $1 billion. Next chatbot is Jasper Chat, which under the hood use the same model as WordTune. It's, you know, behind the login wall, you need to pay, and it's not that easy to use, so let's move on. Next two, Chatbase and Writesonic, are actually designed for the business. So imagine that you've got a small business and you want to automate some FAQ section on your website, or you want to give ability for people to chat and you want to train those assistants on some of the question answer or other conversations. Those companies allow you to embed their chat software into your website for small companies like e-commerce, web shops. I like personally Chatbase a lot because they actually using the open source version of the chat I wrote myself back in December. So I'm really happy to see that other people create projects based on the open source code I wrote, which is cool. Right, next is you.com, which is free and not even require login. And they have access to the internet. And they also list the results on the right. So it's a little bit different UI, different experience. And it's kind of good, but the results are not perfect, not that good compared to ChatGPT. Okay, before we're going to move to Playgrounds, this is the last one. So PoE is like an aggregator where you have many models available, and it's quite okay, fast. The streaming is really fast. But when you want to use other more advanced, there you go. You hit the paywall, which is $200 per year. The next four are actually playgrounds. Those are the environments where you can interact with AI models. For example, here you've got the models from OpenAI. You can give the prompt and you have a lot of the settings, like where you can access different kind of models and also select the particular model you want. And here you've got the ability to actually tweak all the details, including the temperature, which, by the way, if you set the temperature to zero, that would mean that you will remove this hallucination, this lying factor. And this, by the way, in my opinion, basically how the Bing is having those three models, like factual, this one would be creative, etc. Fun fact is that this playground is available for like 2-3 years. Like, this model was available in 2020, and I was using it before ChatGPT was even the thing. The next one is Vercel Playground, and this one is pretty cool because you've got a lot of models in one place, not only from OpenAI, but from other companies. Let's say choose three models, one from Replicate, one from OpenAI, and one from Cohere. And you can add the same prompt and they will stream. Yeah, okay, so OpenAI Turbo Stream and Alpaca, and this is the smallest model, by the way, like it will fit in your phone or your laptop. So that's why it's so poor. And you can compare the results in this playground, which requires login, but it's free apart from GPT-4, because GPT-4 requires a pro account on Vercel to actually have access to this. Here, actually, you can compare the speed between GPT 3.5 Turbo and GPT-4, which you can clearly see the difference. Okay, let's move on. There is actually one more playground to mention, and it's from Nathan. And unfortunately, he's asking for $5 only to just top up the credits. And you've got quite a lot of models available and the chat mode, including Claude Instant 100K. So that is the cheapest option to actually test Claude. But it's really important to understand that this project is actually a private website from Nat Friedman, who is a CEO of GitHub. And he created this playground, shared it to everyone on Twitter. 15th of March, he allowed to compare the models, Cohere, OpenAI, Anthropic, Claude. Pretty cool. And oops, ad. Hey, Twitter got ads. And 2 days later, after he tweeted, he showed the screenshot from the build from OpenAI, only from OpenAI, not to mention other models. Then obviously, because he released it for free, so he hit a viral effect. And a week later, it was so expensive that he started joking that he could just tweet his OpenAI key API. Which nicely bring me up to bring your own key idea. This is exactly the column I was talking about, bring your own key. So that's why I included two other chatbots in this table that allow you to bring your own key from OpenAI. So you don't need to rely on others or some monthly subscriptions or whatever. You just pay what you use directly to the model owner, that is OpenAI. And those two chatbots are actually the best you can have in terms of bring your own key. This is something I use personally. Like the first one, chatbot UI, I use it all the time. So you can actually have your own prompts here. You can define your prompts. You can hide this both and then just focus on chat. You can put your own key here, API key, or for other plugins like searching in Google, and you only pay what you use. Okay, the last thing I want to talk about is a tech stack. So you're probably not technical, but if you're still listening, thank you for that. Subscribe, like if you really enjoy and find it valuable. So this tech stack clearly shows you the winner. And I personally think that this whole ChatGPT moment that happened in November 20 was because of the UI. Like, we know that the Playground was available for a few years, the GPT-3 was available on the market for 2 years, and nobody was like, okay, until the moment ChatGPT was released to the public. And so I think that the UI, this whole technology, this whole chat-based, discussion-based assistant interaction with artificial intelligence, but using a specific technology, for example, Next.js, that allow it to make it so fast, contributed to success of ChatGPT and why we all now talk about AI chatbots. All right, that was a long one. It's supposed to be a 10-minute video. I don't know how long it's gonna be, but if you're still watching, wow. Thank you for watching. Grab the link to the spreadsheet in the description of the video down below. It's yours, you can copy it, use it. If you want to contribute and help me to fill the gaps, I would really appreciate it. And see you in the next video. I'm gonna try something. Hey, you. You know what? I'm gonna try something. Hey, you. Check out this video.